Hi friends, good evening and welcome to Tech Toast with Science Spread. This is your RJ Vidya. Today is Monday and hope you had a wonderful day and may you have a wonderful week ahead. So in this show we always discuss about basically science and math, and sometimes we discuss about technology too. And you're listening Radio Udaan. So today directly let's start off with the science section. Now let's listen to this audio clip. I'm sure it's really interesting.
If the cure for cancer is in the mind of a junior high girl, the odds are that we'll never find it. Because research shows that by the time that girl is in second grade, both boys and girls are well acquainted with the notion that math is for boys. So by the time she reaches junior high school, she will have been laboring under those confidence-zapping stereotypes that say girls can't do things like math and science for at least half a dozen years. Couple that with the fact that the absolute last thing a girl in junior high wants to do is to stand out or be different. And it's no wonder that we lose many bright, capable young women in junior high school because they turn away from math and science at the very time in their lives when so many opportunities in those areas begin to open up for them. Now, it is true that by the time she reaches high school, that today in the United States, 50% of advanced placement calculus students are women. But it's also true 3 months later, when those high school seniors reach the college campus as freshmen, that only 17% of engineering majors are women. And surprisingly, that number hasn't changed in over 20 years. So the odds of that junior high girl getting the education she needs to see her dream of curing cancer become a reality, well, those odds are slim. So why is that? What's going on? What's the problem? Well, largely it's us. It's our society, our culture, if you will. Because we're the ones, whether on purpose or unintentionally, we perpetuate those antiquated, inaccurate, and to be perfectly honest, damaging stereotypes that say things like girls can't do engineering and science. But it's more than that. You see, those stereotypes fuel a lot of what's called implicit or unconscious or unintentional bias against women in engineering and science. And that implicit bias, it turns out, is more damaging than the stereotypes themselves. You see, implicit bias affects our attitudes, our reactions, our expectations of women in engineering and science. It also fuels a continual stream of what are called micro inequities or micro insults aimed at women. Things which by themselves may not look like such a big deal, but collectively, together, over a career, over a lifetime, they can add up to a lot. And they can make it really difficult for a girl or a woman in engineering or science to stick with it, to contribute, to live up to her potential, to dream. Let's look at an example of implicit bias. Research tells us that we all find it really challenging to view a woman in a traditionally male field like engineering or science as competent. We tend to devalue her contributions and dismiss her accomplishments. Let's say that you've been appointed to a new committee at work, and the charge for your committee is to hire an engineer. If I make up a resume for an engineer, just totally make it up, put anything on it that I want to, and I take that resume and I put a man's name at the top, like David, then I take that same resume and I put a woman's name at the top, say Maria, and I take those identical resumes for David and Maria, and I submit those to the hiring committee. Then research shows that the committee will evaluate David as more qualified than Maria every time, even though their resumes are identical. In fact, research suggests that Maria would have to be as much as 2.5 times more competent than David to be rated equal with him. 2.5 times. Wow. It's no wonder we don't have a lot of women and girls in engineering and science. But it doesn't stop there. It turns out that K-12 teachers are susceptible to implicit bias. Research shows that teachers call on boys more in math class than they do girls. That's true even when the teachers think that they're calling on boys and girls the same. It turns out that those stereotypes that say things like girls can't do math and science affect more than just the second graders. It's also true in things like symphony orchestra tryouts. When symphony orchestras go to a double-blind review system, one where the judges and the musicians who are trying out can't see each other, then the number of women that secure traditionally male spots like first chair trumpet skyrocket. You see, if the judges can see the gender of the musicians who are trying out, then their implicit biases, things like women don't play with as much power as men, actually affect their ability to accurately judge what they're hearing. It's the fact that implicit bias is unintentional or unconscious, that we're not even aware that we're doing it, that makes it so damaging. We think that we're being fair and unbiased, when in reality, we're acting in ways that many times are exactly opposite our intended values. Now, I know what you're thinking, but this isn't a guy thing. Research shows that women, that we are just as guilty of implicit bias in all of these situations as men are. It's not a guy thing. Like I said earlier, it's a culture thing, but it's our culture, and we can change it if we want to. We can educate ourselves about implicit bias and its damaging effects. We can look out for its influence on our behavior and our attitudes. We can insist on using objective criteria when we evaluate people instead of subjective opinions. We can do all of those things. We just have to decide that it's important enough to do so. Now, while it's true that our society perpetuates a lot of stereotypes about who can do engineering and science, it's also true that we perpetuate a lot of stereotypes about the disciplines of engineering and science themselves. And those stereotypes turn girls away. I mean, we portray engineers as lonely nerds in white lab coats working on boring theoretical projects in laboratories, when in reality, research shows that girls, and increasingly today, all millennial students, both boys and girls, are far more interested in helping and doing good than they are in building a bigger, better, faster rocket ship. Fortunately, the opportunities to help and do good in engineering and science have never been greater. In 2004, the National Academy of Engineering came out with a list of what they called 14 grand challenges for engineering in the 21st century. Large, complex, interdisciplinary problems facing our world today. Things like coming up with sustainable solutions for our burgeoning energy needs, or developing new treatments and medicines for diseases, or addressing infrastructure issues, things like crumbling roads and bridges and access to clean water, all of which provide unlimited opportunities for engineers and scientists to help and do good. We just need to get that message out to our kids, to our second grade girls. Because if we wait until junior high or high school to start sending the message that a career in engineering and science can give you opportunities to make the world a better place, well, it's too late. So all of this may be well and good, you're thinking, but you know, in the end, why does it really matter? Research shows that starting in kindergarten, that girls study more than boys do, that they value school more than boys do, that they make better grades than boys do. So it should be no surprise that women now outnumber men in college 3-2, and they're also more likely to graduate from college than men are. Now, I'm the mom of a 21-year-old son who's sitting back there, who's majoring in engineering in college. So on the one hand, I know that this data is telling us that we have got to do a better job of engaging boys in school. On the other hand, I know that the data is telling us that if we aren't attracting girls and women to engineering and science, then we aren't going to be producing many engineers or scientists. At the very time in our nation's history when we're under increasing pressure to maintain an innovative edge in the world economy and to solve increasingly complex and challenging scientific and technical problems, all of which requires a substantial pool of engineering and science talent. Something I might add that many other countries don't seem to have much problem producing. Moreover, if we want to solve those really challenging scientific and complex problems, it turns out that we need a diverse team. People of different genders, people from different races, people from different socioeconomic classes, different parts of the country. Because research shows if you want to come up with an innovative solution to a really challenging problem, then a diverse team will trump a team of experts every time. So, if we want that cure for cancer to be there when we need it, then we all have to work at getting the message out to our girls that not only can they do engineering and science, but that we need them to do engineering and science. We need them to dream about using engineering and science to make the world a better place. Because the dreams of that junior high girl aren't just the key to building her future, they're the key to building our future. Thanks.
The world of invention, creativity, and discovery. Here's an opportunity for all of us to explore the ocean of knowledge. This show is all about emerging trends in science and technology, math, quiz, facts, and much more. So friends, get ready to listen Tech Toast with Science Spread with your RJ Vidya only on Radio Udaan. Every Monday from 7 to 8 p.m. and rebroadcast every Tuesday from 2 to 3 p.m.
रेडियो उड़ान सुन रहे सभी मित्रों को मेरा प्यार भरा नमस्कार। मेरा नाम मधु सिंघल है। मैं बेंगलोर में कार्यरत संस्था मित्र ज्योति, जो पिछले 25 वर्षों से दृष्टिहीनों एवं दूसरे विकलांग व्यक्तियों के लिए कार्यरत है, उसकी मैनेजिंग ट्रस्टी हूँ। इस संस्था की गतिविधियाँ इस प्रकार है। यहाँ पर दृष्टिहीनों के लिए ऑडियो में पुस्तकें रिकॉर्ड की जाती हैं। इसके साथ साथ ब्रेल में और स्कैंड पुस्तकें भी उनको दी जा रही हैं। कंप्यूटर प्रशिक्षण और रोजगार की सुविधाएं भी यहाँ प्रदान की जा रही हैं। दृष्टिहीन महिलाओं के लिए एक विशेष प्रकार का कोर्स चलाया जाता है, जिसमें उन्हें आत्मनिर्भर बनकर जीवन में आगे बढ़ने की क्षमता प्रदान की जा रही है। आप मित्र ज्योति से संपर्क कर सकते हैं। यहाँ का फोन नंबर है 08022587623 और 22587625। ईमेल एड्रेस है admin.office@mitrajyoti.org। वेबसाइट है www.mitrajyoti.org।
कहानी वेद पुराणों की, मनोरंजक कहानियाँ, जीवन को राह दिखलाने वाली कहानियाँ, धार्मिक, सांस्कृतिक, सामाजिक और राजनैतिक हर पक्ष को छूती हैं कहानियाँ। तो इन्हीं कहानियों को मैं सुनाने आ रही हूँ, यानी आरजे गीता सुमन, शो कथालोक में हर मंगलवार शाम 7 से 8 और हर बुधवार दोपहर 2 से 3, तो सुनना मत भूलिएगा, सिर्फ और सिर्फ रेडियो उड़ान पर।
दो अंधों की कथा सुनो, इस पर इनका ज्ञान सुनो।
हे फ्रेंड्स, डू यू थिंक दैट लाइफ इज गेटिंग सो स्ट्रेसफुल? Well, if it is so, why not make it quite inspirational, motivational and stress-free? So let us meet in a world of positivity in the show Inspirational Wings Season 2. Every Tuesday 9 to 10 p.m. and repeat every Wednesday 4 to 5 p.m. with RJ Divya Sharma only on Radio Udaan, a flight of life. For more information, visit our website www.radioudaan.com.
हाय हाय, मैं क्या करूं? मेरी बेटी को देखो, अच्छी खासी एक्सपर्ट है हर काम में, कंप्यूटर में भी अच्छी खासी जॉब भी करती है, लेकिन फिर भी जब भी लड़के वाले देखने आते हैं ना, रिजेक्ट करके चले जाते हैं।
पर क्यों?
क्योंकि ना उसको खाना नहीं बनाना आता। क्या करूं?
क्या करूं? ट्यूनिंग करो हर मंगलवार शाम 8 से 9 रेडियो उड़ान पर, जहां मैं आरजे चेतना आपको सिखाऊंगी प्रोग्राम की जनतड़का में जायकेदार डिशेस बनाना।
मोनिका करूंगी आपके लक्ष्य को पाने में आपकी मदद, और बनूंगी आपकी सहभागी आपकी सक्सेस में। लाऊंगी आपके लिए जीके से जुड़े अनछुए पहलू, और शेयर करेंगे हम ज्ञान को। यस फ्रेंड, मैं आज मोनिका ला रही हूँ आपके लिए ज्ञान से सराबोर एक एजुकेशनल प्रोग्राम, जिसका नाम है लेट्स एंजॉय 2020 एवरी मंडे एट 10 टू 11 पीएम एंड रिपीट ब्रॉडकास्ट ऑन ट्यूसडे 5 टू 6 पीएम ओनली ऑन रेडियो उड़ान।
सजा दिया, पहली नजर में ही तुझे अपना बना लिया है।
Thank you all for being here. Thank you to the organizers and sponsors for the chance to be here. Isn't it great to mark an agreement in Northern Ireland? But I'm going to be slightly more contentious in the next 15 minutes. I'm going to talk a bit about women in science, drawing largely on my own experience. I'm originally Northern Irish, came from the Lurgan area, and I started my secondary education in Lurgan. Do you remember starting secondary school? All those new subjects? You moved to different classrooms, you had different teachers. And it was terrific, except for one thing. On the Wednesday morning of the first week, a message went round the first year class. This afternoon, girls to such and such a room, boys to such and such a room. And I thought it was sport. That's where they're dividing us. It wasn't. The girls got sent to the domestic science room and the boys to the science lab. No asking, just telling. That's where you went. I protested unsuccessfully. But when my parents heard that night, they hit the roof. As did the local GP, who had a daughter in the same class, as did one or two other sets of parents. And the next time the science class met, there were three girls and all the boys. And the teacher made us three girls sit right under his nose. I came top in the science exam at the end of that term, which I was quite pleased about because I'd failed the qualifying. And I think I'd been quite cut up about that. I'd love to think the school learnt a lesson, but I hae me doots. And this is the context. So the school's action wasn't totally surprising. This is material from a women's magazine from 1955. Advice to a new young wife. It's evening time, hubby's about to come home from work. Have dinner ready, have the fire burning, have the house tidy, have the kids clean and quiet. Remember, he's the master of the house. You have no right to question him. A good wife always knows her place. Listen to him. His topics of conversation are much more important than yours. And don't complain if he stays out late or all night. What advice? Advice on how to be a doormat. But also, what a long way we have come from 1955. And it's not been an easy journey for the women or for the men. All our roles have had to change. Well, it turned out that I was good at physics. I went on to read a physics degree at Glasgow University. I was the only woman in the honours class. And there was a tradition in Glasgow University at that time that when a woman entered the lecture hall, all the guys already in the hall stamped, whistled, catcalled, banged the desk, made as much unpleasant noise as they could. It was a little isolating. I had to work very much on my own. But the next stage was where I wanted to be. I wanted to be an astronomer, preferably a radio astronomer, and I got to do a PhD in Cambridge, and as William alluded, stumble over some interesting objects along the way. Throughout my working life, I've been either one of very few women or the most senior woman in the place. Now, concentrate for this little bit. You need to do some mental arithmetic. My appointment to the chair of physics at the Open University doubled the number of female professors of physics in the country, from 1 to 2. We're now somewhere about 60 out of several hundred. And I became the first female president of the Institute of Physics of UK and Ireland. And that's fairly typical of how my career has been. And incidentally, it was only when I became a professor of physics that I thought again about failing the qualifying. I'd rather buried it. And I thought, hey, isn't there something a little stupid here? And started talking about it rather late in life. I want to say a bit about women in astronomy today around the world. And I've got a table of data which I'm afraid you're not going to be able to read because the screen's too small. But I'll... Yeah, there we go. This is international data compiled by the international body. They've looked at the size of the astronomical community in each country in the world, and they've got that number broken down by gender, so they're able to say what fraction of each country's professional astronomy body is female. And Argentina comes in top with 37% of its professional astronomical community being women. And perhaps no surprise, Japan comes in bottom with 6%. The world average is 15%. 15% of professional astronomers are female. The UK comes in below the world average at 12%. If a third of Argentinians' astronomers are women, it doesn't seem to me that there's a problem with women's brains. It's something to do with the culture in the different countries that produces this enormous change from country to country. The limiting factor is culture, not women's brains, and I regret that it's still necessary to say that. And if anybody wants to look further at the data, there's the web reference where you can get it. Which brings me to diversity. In research science, particularly when we have an economic recession, science, technology, engineering, maths are incredibly important to help build a smart economy to get us out of trouble. We need all the talent there is. We need all the bright ideas there are as well, and we cannot afford to be turning aside from a fair chunk of the population. A research group in science that is diverse is strong. It brings more creativity, more flexibility, more robustness, more success, because of the diversity and the range of ideas and people coming at it from different angles. However, the easiest group to manage is a group of people that think alike. In our context, that means white males with similar backgrounds. A diverse group is much harder to manage. And the members of a diverse group, some will see it as exciting, but others will find it uncomfortable and threatening. Just depends on your temperament. But that's really where we should be, in diverse groups, with, of course, brilliant managers so that it all works well. I was encouraged to say a bit about how we've managed to increase, just a little bit, the fraction of women in the science community. First of all, we do need to recognize that we're changing society, we're changing attitudes, we're changing cultures in the workplace. And it's not just Pirelli calendars, it's all sorts of factors in a workplace. And we also need to acknowledge that changing society is slow and painful. The journey that Northern Ireland has been on over the last 20 years has been slow and painful. And it's a similar situation for increasing the number of women in some of these areas where there are very few. There have been lots of initiatives to increase the number of women in science, usually started by an overworked woman in her workplace because she sees the need to support other women who are coming along alongside her or behind her. Great. Don't want to deny the value of that, but it's local, it's ad hoc, and it's not joined up with anything else. There's been a lot of that, and a lot of the improvement in the number of women in science has simply been due to those kinds of efforts. But it's time now that we moved away from the ad hoc and the scattergun, and we had some kind of strategy. And where better than in a place like this to say, strategic thinking needed. Somebody alluded to purchasing. Simon alluded to purchasing. People who purchase have immense power. Check out your suppliers. Are they good employers of women? Public sector equality duty? Blah, 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 blah. So a strategic approach, very important. But the other thing that's absolutely essential when you're trying to grow a diverse community is to be able to hear what those people from the different backgrounds are saying. You need to be able to listen and hear and understand their experience. And sometimes it's quite shocking and often it's unexpected, so you need to be open to that. Stereotypes don't work. So one of my important how-to things is saying, ensure that women are recognized and honored as women. Those of us who've been early in a field have often had to behave like we males, she males, we men, viragos, Amazonians, hell of a lot of words for this. Or put more bluntly, we've had to play the male game because we're in such a small minority. And I hate to think what a lifetime of doing that has actually done to me. Don't answer the question, thank you. We also need to encourage women to apply for jobs, promotion, funding, and so on, because women still in our culture are a bit more tentative than the men. However, I wouldn't mind if the culture moved a bit towards women as well. I think that's very important. A lot of the programs to support women in science and engineering assume that the problem lies with the women, and the scientific society is absolutely fine, thank you. Actually, it's male, because it's been dominated by males, named by males, interpreted by males forever. So I think the culture of science needs to change as well. Women scientists, being few, often don't have the same networks, so it's useful to be able to encourage networks. And of course, there are the family commitments. There's still the feeling that kids have mothers, but apparently don't have fathers. One of the important things that's beginning to happen is encouraging men to take paternity leave, as well as mothers taking maternity leave. In Finland, the male has to take 3 months paternity leave. If he doesn't, the couple lose it. Scientists, male scientists who do that, come back better scientists. And if you're interested in learning more about this, I'd commend to you the Queen's University work. They've got some very good programs running. We also need to learn about institutional sexism. Down the bottom of this slide, there's a little bit of an application form, and I've ringed the bit that says gender. There are two boxes. What do you guess the first box is? They're not in alphabetical order. Male first, female second. Why? Why still? I think in my case, several decades of ticking the second box has probably taken its toll. We also need to learn about unconscious bias. Men and women discriminate against women. It seems to be the way we're wired. We need to know about it. And as a final thought, a quotation from a woman at Donna's establishment: well-behaved women rarely make history. Yeah, my generation couldn't afford to be well-behaved. Thank you for your interest.
Now, coming to math section, I've got a trick for you. And this trick is so simple, and I think this is the most simplest trick. This is the simplest trick that I'm going to tell you. This trick is so easy that you can easily solve it in your mind itself. And this trick is to subtract any number from 1000. Sometimes we really get few numbers to be subtracted from 1000, and let's find out how easily we can do this. For example, 1000 minus 243 or 1000 minus 384 or 1000 minus 995, etc. Let's take an example. First, let's see how to subtract 1000 minus 144. 1000 minus 144. So 144 is nothing but 144. 1 is in the hundredths place, 4 is in the tens place, and 4 is in the units place. Now, let's start from left. 1 is to the left and 4 is in 4 is 1 is to the left and 4 is in the right of 1, and another 4 is in right of another 4. So let's start from left. 1 is to the extreme left and 4 is to the right, extreme right. So starting from left, we have to subtract all numbers from 9 except the units place, which is to the extreme right. We have to subtract it from 10. In 144, that is for 144, it's 144. Let's try doing it. First, let's start from the left. Subtract 9 minus 1 and write it down, which is 8. Now, next number is 4. So, subtract 9 minus 4, which gives you 5. Write it to the right of 8 in the answer. And next, the rightmost digit is 4. So, this 4 you have to subtract it from 10. So, 10 minus 4 gives you 6. Write it to the right of 5. Now the answer will be 856. Don't get confused. Let me explain it again. 1000 minus 144. So 144 is written as 144. Starting from the left, subtract 9 minus 1, because 1 is the first digit starting from left. So 9 minus 1 gives you 8, so write it down in the answer. Next number is to the right of 1, we have 4. So 9 minus 4 gives us 5. So write it down to the right of 8 in the answer. Next comes 4, which is to the extreme right, and it is in the units place, and only this number should be subtracted from 10. That is 10 minus 4 gives us 6. Let's take another example to understand this clearly. Let's take 1000 minus 562. 1000 minus 562. 562 is nothing but 562. Now starting from the left, 5 is to the left, so subtract 9 minus 5, which gives us 4. So write it down. Next number, we have 6, because I told you 562. So next number, we have 6, which is to the right of 5. Now subtract 9 minus 6 and we get 3. Write it down to the right of 4 in the answer. And the last number we have to the extreme right, which is 2. And this time, this 2 should be subtracted from 10. So 10 minus 2 gives you 8. And that should be written to the right of 3 in the answer. So the answer is nothing but 438. Let's take another example so that this time it's surely going to be easy for you. Let's take 1000 minus 321. So 321 can be written as 3, 2, 1. 3 is to the left and 2 is to the right of 3 and 1 is in the units place. So 3, 2, 1, which is nothing but 321. This is the number, that is 1000 minus 321. Now let's see how to calculate 1000 minus 321. So first take 3, subtract it from 9. So 9 minus 3 is nothing but 6, write it down. Next we have 2, subtract it from 9. So 9 minus 2 gives us 7. So write it down to the right of 6 in the answer. The last number we have 1, and this 1 should be subtracted from 10. So 10 minus 1 gives us 9. So write it in the units place of the answer. Now the answer is 679. That is 9 minus 3 is 6, 9 minus 2 is 7, and 10 minus 1 is 9, because we had 321 in the question. Hope this is clear. So 1000 minus 321 gives us 679. Remember that we have to subtract all the digits of the number from 9 except the last digit, that is the units digit, we have to subtract it from 10. And this will give us the answer. And 1000 minus any number, you can do it in this way very, very easily. Hope this is clear to you and you have understood this trick, and it might help you in some way if you have to calculate. Now let's take a look at another simple math trick. This is also very, very simple. This trick is to multiply any number with 5 very, very easily. If you want to multiply any number with 5, this trick works. So a simple rule is, here in this trick you have to know what is whole number. Whole number can be any number like 15, 20, 30, 2500, 2008, 62, anything. Any simple number is called whole number. And any number that has points like 2400.62, all these are not whole numbers. 23.74 or 48.62 or 1 by 3, 1 by 4, 2 by 8, all these are not whole numbers. Just the numbers that you use generally, the simple numbers without any fraction or points, are called as whole numbers. Anything like 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 15, all these simple numbers are called as whole numbers. Now, remember one thing. If you want to multiply any number with 5, what you should do is, you should first divide the number by 2. And once you divide the number by 2, in case you get a whole number, that's any number without complications like points or fractions, etc., then you have to add a 0 to the number after dividing it by 2. In case you get a point, a decimal point or something, then you just have to take the whole number part of it and add a 5 to it. Don't get confused. Let's be clear. I have taken 3 examples. Let me tell you how to work this out. But remember one thing. You always have to divide the number by 2. In case you get a whole number, just add a 0 to the answer. And in case you get a decimal, that is points, just take the whole number part of it and add 5 to the answer. This is very simple. Very simple actually. Let's really take an example. Say you want to multiply 45 into 5. So how do you multiply 45 into 5? First, you divide 45 by 2. When you try to divide 45 by 2, you can divide 45 by 2. So how to divide is 4 divided by 2 gives you 2 and 5 divided by 2 actually gives you 2, that is 2 to the 4 and 1 is the remainder. So here you get points. So you get 22 point something. Now leave that point something, just take the 22. The number that comes before point is the whole number. So just take 22 and add a 5 to it, which becomes 225. So 45 into 5 is 225. Just take the 22 and add a 5 to it. And let's take another example. Take 35 into 5. When you want to multiply 35 into 5, how do you do? The same thing. When you divide 3 by 2, that is 2 ones are 2 and 1 is the remainder, so 15, and 2 sevens are 14. So you get 17 point something. So leave that point something and take only 17. So 35 divided by 5 is 17 point something. So take only 17 and add 5 at the end. That becomes 1, 7 and 5. So it is 175. So 35 into 5 is 175. Now you know, if points come, just ignore whatever comes after point. Take only the whole number and add a 5 at the end and that becomes your answer. Now let's take another example where you don't get points. Take 132 multiplied by 5, that is 132 into 5. Now try dividing 132 by 2 as usual. That is, first take 13, so 2 sixa is 12 and 1 remainder, so again 12. If you bring down 2, you get again 2 sixa, 12. So 132 by 2 gives you 66. Now you don't have points for this. So what you do is, instead of adding a 5, just add a 0. It becomes 660. So 132 divided by 2 is nothing but 66 and adding a 0, it becomes 660. So 132 into 5 is 660. Remember, when you don't get points, just add a 0, and when you do get points, just ignore whatever comes after the point and add 5 to the existing answer. That is, take the whole number part of it which comes before point and add a 5 at the end. Or let's take another example. Say you have 2620 by 2620 into 5. So first, as usual, you divide 2620 by 2. When you divide, you get 1310. Now you get 1310, that is 2620 divided by 2 gives you 1310. So 1310. Now here you don't have any points for this, you get a whole number, so add a 0 at the end. If you add 0 to 1310, it becomes 13,100. So 2620 into 5 is nothing but 13,100. It's very simple. Just don't worry about it. When you get a whole number, say for example you want to divide 66 by 5. What you do, divide it by 2, you get 33. 66 by 2 gives you 33. Add a 0. Simple. Because you don't get any points in this, just add a 0. You get 330. So 66 divided by 5 is 330. But say for example you want to multiply 13 into 5. So in this case what you do, take 13, you get 13 divided by 2, what you get is 6 point something. So leave that point something and take only 6, and to the right of 6 just add a 5, it becomes 65. So it's very easy. If you get a point, for all sums you have to divide it by 2 first, you have to divide the number by 2. In case you get a whole number, just add a 0 to the right. In case you get some points, answer in points, just ignore the numbers that come after point, and only before point you have to take and add 5 to the right of it. That's it. It's very simple. As you practice, you will easily get it. Hope you understood the trick. So, now we have come to the end of the show. Hope you have enjoyed all the topics discussed today. I think these topics were quite interesting, and hope you found all the information interesting. To give your feedback, you can visit www.radioudaan.com, that is www.radioudaan.com, and you can give your feedback. And don't forget to give me feedback, because I have to improve in the next show. And in case you want to send in any interesting science articles you find, or you want to send in any mail, please send it to vidya.y@radioudaan.com. That is vidhya.y@radioudaan.com. So this was your show, Tech Toast with Science Spread, and I'm your RJ Vidya. Next week we'll meet with the same show at the same time. Till then, have a wonderful week ahead. Take care of your health and yourself. Goodbye.
खुदा है दुआ ऐसा हो नहीं, खाना पीना साथ है, मरना जीना साथ है, खाना पीना साथ है, मरना जीना साथ है, सारी जिंदगी ये दोस्ती हम नहीं तोड़ेंगे, तोड़ेंगे चंबकर तेरा साथ ना छोड़ेंगे, ये दोस्ती हम नहीं